one of the things that Brian brought up, which I thought was the most fascinating, was the role to which that malaria played in the development of African slavery in the United States or in the Americas.
Yeah, talk a little bit about that.
Yeah. Well, one way to think about it is in 1776, this great economist, Adam Smith, sort of founded economics by writing The Wealth of Nations. We're too busy over here having our revolution to really notice, but he wrote this incredible book, which is basically the foundation of modern economics. And if you read the book, you find four or five times in this big long book, Adam Smith tries to deal with slavery, and basically he cannot figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
He says, no, wait a minute. Look at these guys. You're dragging them over here. They don't speak your language. They're from tropical countries. They don't farm wheat over there. And they also, most important, they have no desire to work for you because they hate you.
Right. Mm-hmm. Some historian said one time that the civil rights struggle began. He asked a bunch of historians, when did you think it began? Well, the Birmingham, 1963, and everybody had their different ideas. He said, wrong. It began when the first African slave was brought to the New World.
Yeah.
That's when the civil rights, nobody is a slave. You are put in slavery.
Right.
Right.
And they hate it. They hate it. Of course they do. I mean, you're taking their liberty. You're wrecking their family. I mean, you know, it's the worst thing you can imagine. They're like the worst workers in the world,
mm-hmm.
right? You know, why should they be good workers?
Yeah.
And so then he looks at this, Adam Smith does, and he says, wait a minute. We have indentured servants. And this is his deal that in the 17th century, the first two-thirds, about two out of three of the people who came to our country were indentured servants.
Mm-hmm.
And the way it works is you're a poor guy in England. You don't have any prospects. So you sign up. And they pay for your passage, and then you work for 4 to 7 years over here for somebody, and then you get to go off and start your own farm.
Mm-hmm.
And that deal worked well for decades upon decades in England and France and so forth. And he said, why did they go for slavery? Why would they take Europeans who speak the language, know what to farm, and have an incentive to do a good job, and then replace them with these other people who cost more and hate you and want to kill you?
Mm.
He never comes up with an answer. And one of the things that was discovered in the 1970s was that malaria and yellow fever, which is this kind of other companion disease that usually goes along with yellow fever.
But both indigenous, I think, to not just to Africa, but also to East Asia and things?
Yeah. Malaria, they both originated, they're really ancient diseases. They both originated, a long time ago in Africa, but they've subsequently spread to other tropical places. They're all associated with certain types of mosquitoes. But it's a very, very easily transmittable disease. And what happens is that when Europeans come, they inadvertently bring it over. And roughly speaking, the Mason-Dixon line is right where falciparum malaria, which is the worst kind of malaria, can survive. North of the Mason-Dixon line, it's too cold.
Mm.
And so it's an occasional presence. South of the Mason-Dixon line, it's there all the time.
So the Mason-Dixon line, which is the slavery line, is the same as the malaria line.
Right. It's a kind of a striking coincidence. And Europeans can't survive there. It just, you bring over these indentured servants, and they all get sick, and you have to wait for a year or two to find out if they're going to kick the bucket or not.
Wow.
Meanwhile, you're feeding them, you're nursing them. So it suddenly becomes much, much more expensive to have European servants. Now, Africans, people from, the malarial areas of Central and West Africa, because they have lived, and their ancestors have lived with malaria for so long, they
have natural immunity.
Natural types of immunities to them, both in genetic, and there's various forms of this. There's something called G6HD. There's something called sickle cell anemia. There's a whole bunch of them.
Mm.
They have these types of, and they also have acquired. When you get a certain strain of malaria, or you get it, or yellow fever, if you survive, you're immune to that strain forever.
Right.
The way if you have chicken pox
or
once
hepatitis
when you're a kid, you don't get it, or hepatitis, that kind of thing. So over there, you have the world's largest pool of people who are immune to these diseases. And the great historian Philip Curtin calculated that at that point, it suddenly starts to make sense.
Mm-hmm.
Economic sense to have slavery, because it's much better to have an unwilling worker who hates you than a dead one.